So today let's make another episode of my Solid State Tesla Coil series. But now let's diverge. I have to explain what's a so-called reverse transfer capacitance, also called Miller capacitance. It's basically an internal capacitance of a MOSFET or IGBT transistor from its drain to its gate or from its collector to its gate in case of IGBT transistor. Without explaining this, it's not possible to explain the gate waveforms you are going to see in the future measurements. The previous gate waveform measurements were done without loading the collector of the transistor. But the later measurements will be done with the collector loaded. So now the gate waveforms will be influenced by this capacitance. So I hope you remember the gate waveform measurements from the previous episode. If you haven't seen it, watch it first. But of course I have to stress that those measurements are taken without any voltage on the collectors of the transistors. It's basically just the control circuitry powered, but there is no main power for the transistors to switch. And of course this can make a difference because of the internal capacitances of the transistor. And you already know that the IGBT transistor or MOSFET has some capacitance of the gate, which is basically acting like this. When you want to turn it on, you have to charge this capacitor, and when you want to turn it off, you have to discharge it. And of course, because you want to minimize the losses in the transistor, you want to turn it on or off as fast as possible. So you also have to charge or discharge this capacitor as fast as possible to minimize the time when the transistor is halfway on. So it's simple so far, but it's going to get more complicated. The transistor also has some other internal capacitances, like this from collector to emitter, which is also called an output capacitance, and this one is called a gate capacitance or input capacitance. And this capacitance is not so concerning, but there is also a so-called reverse transfer or Miller capacitance. And it's the capacitance from the collector to the gate. And here's the problem. When you want to turn the transistor on, you have to raise the voltage on its gate. So when it's turning on, the voltage goes up here. But as it's turning on, it pulls the voltage of the collector down. So the voltage goes down here. And as it goes down here, it also forces the voltage of the gate down through this capacitance. So it basically works against the gate driver. And a similar problem happens when you want to turn it off. When you turn it off, you pull the voltage down on the gate, but as it's turning off, the load basically pulls the voltage up on the collector when the transistor is no longer conductive. So the voltage goes up here and it pulls the voltage up on the gate. So it again works against the gate driver. Without any load, you just simply charge or discharge the gate. You charge it like this and discharge it like this. But when the transistor is loaded, the voltage on the collector goes up and down as it turns off and on. And this reverse capacitance works against the gate driver. And it has the biggest effect when the voltage is changing on the collector the fastest. And the gate threshold voltage for high currents is about 8 or 9 volts. At about 8 or 9 volts on the gate, the transistor starts passing a high current and it can pull the voltage down here and apply a voltage to a load. So at about 8 or 9 volts on the gate, the voltage of the collector changes the fastest and also the effect of this capacitance, the reverse capacitance, is the highest. So in reality, when you try to turn the transistor on, you basically charge the gate until the point where the transistor starts turning on. And as it's turning on, the collector voltage goes quickly down, and this is most apparent at about 8 volts. And you try to charge the gate, but also this capacitance is trying to discharge it. So the voltage gets kind of stuck at about 8 volts for some time, when the voltage on the collector is changing the fastest, and when the collector reaches more or less the destination voltage, the gate voltage can continue changing like this. So let's imagine the transistor switches some load with this voltage on it, and As it's turning on, it pulls the voltage on the collector down. So it starts turning on slowly, and then here it's turning on the fastest, and actually the collector voltage is going down the fastest. And then it kind of reaches 0 volts, or nearly 0 volts, actually about 2 volts, because of the voltage drop of the transistor. And in this region where the collector voltage is falling the fastest, the reverse capacitance has the highest effect, and it kind of prevents the gate voltage from going up, because as the collector voltage falls down, it also pushes down the gate voltage via the reverse capacitance. And this threshold voltage depends on the particular transistor and also the current it's switching, but most IGBT transistors at a high current will have about 8 volts. And of course a similar thing can happen when you turn the transistor off. The gate voltage goes down, it gets stuck here, and then it can continue. And again, this happens when the collector voltage goes up the fastest. And of course a similar problem happens even for MOSFETs, except that this threshold voltage is much lower for MOSFETs. And of course also all transistors have some delay, so it's maybe a little bit more complicated than this simplified diagram. And this plateau will actually happen a bit later, because the changes of the collector voltage are delayed. And this is for a single transistor power supply, but if you have a half bridge like this, it's getting even more complicated, because another problem is that when one transistor turns on, it pulls the collector of the other transistor up, and it also can pull the voltage on the other gate up. Now let's imagine the upper transistor is turning on. As it turns on, the voltage here will go up, and as it goes up, the reverse capacitance of this transistor will pull its gate up and try to turn it on. Which is quite a big problem, because when this one turns on, this one shouldn't turn on too, because then it's a short circuit. So the gate driver of the other transistor has to keep the gate voltage down. But when it has a series resistor, the voltage will shoot up a little bit on the gate, but it shouldn't be too much. It should be below about 5 volts, because this is the voltage where the transistor passes no current. But of course, to make it safer, it should be way less than this. And my oscilloscope measurements so far were done with no voltage here. And of course, I don't want to connect my oscilloscope to it when it's connected to mains, but let's try to connect it to a bench power supply with about 30 volts. And the gate driver has about 15 volts on it. So now let's try to test it in those conditions. And of course the problem with the half bridge works both ways. When this transistor turns on, the voltage from the collector to emitter here goes up, and it also pushes the voltage on this gate up. So here's the voltage on the gates, and as the upper transistor turns on, it pulls the voltage up a little bit on the gate of the other transistor, and the same happens here. This one turns on, and the voltage of the gate of this one goes a bit up here. But of course this shouldn't be enough to turn it on. So here's the voltage of the control chip. It basically is powered via a resistor, and it clamps the voltage using its internal zener. And now let's try to use 30 volts as the main power for the half bridge. And I can turn this voltage on and off using this switch. And here's the gate of the lower transistor, and let's see what happens when the half bridge has its voltage. When I turn the voltage of the half bridge on, you can see this. It's the effect of the reverse transfer capacitance. It basically works against the changes of the gate voltage. And it even forces the voltage back a little bit. Let's zoom it. You can see it forces the voltage back down on the gate. But there is still nothing when it's going down, when it's basically discharging the gate and turning the transistor off. But this is probably because it's not loaded. So let's connect some load to the output of it here. I already have a terminal block here, and I plan to use some lamps at the output. So the half bridge is not yet loaded. The upper trace is the output of the half bridge and the lower trace is the gate voltage of the lower transistor. And now let's load it. And it's loaded. And the output is kind of ringing. And the gate voltage of the transistor, when it's not loaded, the reverse capacitance pushes the gate voltage back when it's going up. And the other transistor turning on forces the gate voltage to go up here, this spike. And when it's loaded, the half bridge kind of oscillates here. And the gate voltage, let's zoom it a little bit. And yes, the gate voltage when it's going up is still getting stuck here. And it's also a little bit getting stuck here when it's going down. And the other transistor turning on pushes the gate of this transistor up a little bit here. So this is it. With no half bridge power, the gate voltage looks much nicer. But when the half bridge is powered, it kind of looks distorted. But this peak here is very small. It doesn't seem that it could turn the transistor on. So it seems kind of fine. But of course there is also some ringing because of the stray inductances of those wires and the capacitances of those snapper network capacitors. But it actually doesn't look that horrible. And when I bypass the gate resistor, it looks a bit more tame, but not that much. This is with the gate resistor and without it. With the gate resistor bypassed, this peak is smaller because then it can keep the gate voltage down better. But even with the gate resistor, the gate voltage overshoot is here less than 1 volt, so it should be safe. So that's my cat on my papers as always and the Miller effect caused by the Miller capacitance of the transistors, which can be seen in switching transistors as this plateau region. And now of course the gate of the transistor wasn't driven with much current. It was driven like this using a 15 ohm resistor. In the next episodes I can try a better gate driver, for example like this with the discharging current amplified or with both charging and discharging current amplified. And of course my cat on my chair again with no legs. And of course the Miller effect doesn't only happen in transistors, it also happens in vacuum tubes. It was already discovered in vacuum tubes about 100 years ago and it's of course named after the person who discovered it. In a vacuum tube there is also a capacitance from the anode to the grid. So they also experience the Miller effect. And now it was all tested this way, powered from 30 volts, the chip powered via a resistor from this, and it has an internal zener, and with this capacitive divider and those snubber networks. And it was loaded using lamps, which is a resistive load, but also the inductance of the leads was actually quite important here. At this frequency, the inductance of the wires was already quite significant. And this is why it was ringing. If it was a purely resistive load, the output would look like this. The voltage would basically be in the middle during the dead time. But in reality there is a ringing because the inductance oscillates with the capacitance of those snubber networks. So in this episode I managed to explain the Miller capacitance and of course I recorded way more footage than I expected and I had to split it into more episodes than I planned, of course. But of course it's still a bit simplified. There is really quite a black magic happening in the transistor. All the internal capacitances are voltage dependent, as I showed you in the datasheet of one transistor in one of the previous episodes. And there is a little plateau even with the collector not loaded. But let's leave this as a mystery. The explanation is on my cat. So this is Dark New Wild and see you in my next videos and thanks to all of my patrons on Patreon. I really appreciate your support. And in the next episodes, I will finally try a better gate driver, and I will also try to load it using various inductive loads and measure the waveforms, and also try to see the effect of changing the capacitances and resistances in the snubber networks.